All right, welcome back. And to continue this discussion on the face-off between the acting chairman of EFCC, Ibrahim Magu, and the Senate, I'm being joined by the president of the Committee for the Defense of Human Rights, Malachi Ogumadu, who is also a lawyer. Malachi, thank you very much for joining us on the program. First, give me your thoughts on the refusal of the Senate to confirm Magu for the second time.
Well, I'm happy you're saying that this is the second time that the Senate or the Federal Republic of Nigeria has refused to confirm the appointment of Mr. Ibrahim Magu as the substantive chairman of the Economic and Financial Crimes Commission. Frankly speaking, I think that this is a very sad moment for Nigeria. This is a very disturbing moment for the crusade against corruption in this country. It is also a sad commentary on the part of the Senate of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, having exhibited what one could clearly call a complete disconnect between them and those they represent. The general consensus out there, without prejudice to the pockets of persons who are opposed to the appointment of Ibrahim Magu, is that this is a man that has brought credibility to that commission. This is a man that has reinvented not just the will but the capacity of that law enforcement agency to deal squarely with this debilitating menace of corruption in Nigeria. And therefore, it came as a very huge surprise to the Nigerian people, who thought that they must have learned their lesson this time around, following the reaction of the Nigerian people when he was initially rejected. And in that particular case, he was not even screened, let alone given the opportunity to respond and defend some of the allegations that were leveled against him. But by and large, we are particularly concerned about a Senate and members of the same Senate that has proclaimed the Constitution as the organic law, and to which they have also sworn to protect the provisions of the same Constitution, and taking steps that are completely at variance, not just with the expectation of the people they represent, but in total disregard of the same Constitution that they sought to protect. In this regard, I reference Section 15, Subsection 5 of the 1999 Constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria as amended. In that 1999 Constitution, it is clearly declared as one of the fundamental objectives and directive principle of state policy that the government of Nigeria shall abolish all forms of corruption and abuse of power. Pursuant to that constitutional provision, you now have in existence a specific agency of government specifically mandated and designed to deal with the challenge of corruption and financial crimes in the country. In that regard, the president has made the appointment of a person whom he believes can handle the situation. That appointment was initially rejected on account of the fact that they have a security report from the Directorate of State Security, the DSS. And it took the intervention and objective interrogation of that reaction by the president, who recommended that the allegations so contained should be investigated. Thereafter, the president came to the conclusion that they were not just hollow, they were unfounded and cannot grant any such rejection, and therefore, within his power, re-represented the same name. Now, one would have thought...
Malak, if you can hear me, I just want to ask you a question. Sorry to interject you, but would you blame the senators? Even if the Senate does not want to confirm Magu, you also have to blame the executive, because an agency in the executive, I'm talking about the DSS now, actually sent a report again to say that Magu should not be confirmed. As a matter of fact, that you know, he's not a man of integrity. So how do you reconcile that? So it's like you have a situation where the Senate, well, maybe doesn't want to confirm him, but the executive is providing the Senate with the document to use to nail Magu as well.
I thank you for this intervention. Quite frankly, the Senate cannot take all the blame. And so, as a matter of fact, in my humble view, and as one who is closely monitoring the situation, I think that the president and the presidency should take a larger chunk of the blame that has arisen out of this very confusing situation. Now, I give you my reason for that. Apart from the Senate, every other actor in the web of this whole process is within the executive arm of government, from the president to the directorate of the director of state service. And to further compound the poverty of the situation is when you realize that the president, who is the president of the Federal Republic of Nigeria and the commander-in-chief of the armed forces and the leader of the political power, a political party in power, has failed abysmally, if you ask me, to coordinate its acts in such a way that the entire nation is not thrown into this embarrassing situation. Now, I'm not going to labor too much in reminding the viewers that virtually every principal actor in the Senate, which is the legislature, together with a preponderant number of members of the Senate, have one question or the other to answer before many law enforcement agencies, including EFCC. As a fact, even the Senate president was not just investigated by the man seeking to be confirmed. His father was also investigated by the same person. And so a lot of people have wondered, to what extent can you get justice out of such arrangement where you are now sitting in judgment over your prosecutor? Mind you, I didn't use the word persecutor. And I think that this is precisely where the Nigerian people and the Nigerian state has become the grass, the proverbial grass that suffers where, in the midst of interplay of such forces. But please permit me and grant me the indulgence to inform that the Economic and Financial Crime Commission Establishment Act clearly gives that right to the Senate under Section 2, Subsection 3, to confirm the appointment so made by the President regarding whoever should be the substantive chairman of the Economic and Financial Crime Commission. Where this has become a problem is that if you cast your mind back to the first episode, because we need to be a little historical clear to understand what is going on. Ibrahim Magu was appointed in an acting capacity for as much as 13 months, which is over a year. It took the Senate over 6 months to, to screen him I'm talking about from the moment when his name was forwarded to the Senate for screening, and in December, when they refused to screen him, citing the security report as the basis. It took the outcry of the Nigerian people to say no. Whereas you have the right, under the act establishing the institution, to confirm the appointment, which is what you are expected to do as a collaborative organ of government that should participate in the process of such appointment, you do not have the right to refrain from exercising that power. And it was at that point that they had to organize the first screening exercise. But it wasn't a screening exercise because, as you recall, he was not even interrogated. The language of the spokesperson who came out to brief the Nigerian people was that, given the security report we have from DSS, we are unable to proceed. We are unable to commence the process of even screening you. And here was a man against whom certain allegations constituting the basis of the refusal to accept him as nominated and appointed by the president. Yet he was not given the opportunity to be heard with respect to the allegations leveled against him. And when those allegations came before the president said, no, it is true that I must be certain that whoever occupies this sensitive position must not just be above board, but must be seen to be above board. Consequently, I hereby refer the complaints and reservations and allegations against this gentleman to the chief law officer of the country, who is the attorney general of the country. When the attorney general announced his report, it was clear to the president that the three allegations against this man cannot stand. And in any case, what has become the concern of the Nigerian people is to say, is this man performing? Even as an acting chairman of EFCC, have we witnessed a vista of fresh air, a re-energized commission, one that has demonstrated the capacity to take this challenge head on? Have we seen that? The answer is yes. It is yes in the form of the arrests, the prosecutions, the convictions, even in the recoveries that have been made so far. A few weeks ago, the governor of my own state, Delta State, was celebrated to high heavens. Even when he is an ex-convict, convicted in no other place than the United Kingdom. And he was given a heroic welcome. Before then, we have had almost the same disposition of our people with the release of Mr. George, what's his name? The former PDP man. And so, displacing the age-long virtue of the African man, no less the Nigerian people, that crime does not pay, that those who are involved in criminal and fraudulent activity should be ostracized from our society. Today, the opposite is the case. They are not just celebrated, they are given heroic welcome, and they are pointed at. The next generation of Nigerians are looking at them not as villains, but as heroes, whose only offense is that they looted the collective treasury of this country.
I'm afraid we'll just have to end it there. Unfortunately, we haven't got time on our hands, but let's just wait and see how all of this plays out. If the president will renominate Ibrahim Magu and submit his name to the Senate for confirmation for the third time, we just have to wait and see. But all the same, we want to thank you for your contributions and thank you for your thoughts. That's Malachi Ogumadu, the president of the Committee for the Defense of Human Rights. Well, That's it on the program. If you want to watch it again, it's simple. All you just have to do is go to our website. It's tv360nigeria.com. You'll find this program and, of course, lots more there. You can also follow us on YouTube. Our YouTube channel is youtube.com/TV360Nigeria. Now do subscribe to get the latest videos and updates. And of course, you can follow us on Google Plus. That's the address is at TV360Nigeria. And of course, on Facebook, it's facebook.com/TV360Online. And then our Twitter handle is at TV360Online. Thank you very much for watching. We'll see you again next week.